Hello, I'm Richard Ager. Welcome to New Hampshire Outlook. At the State House, legislative leaders have been caught in a monumental struggle to accomplish two things: find enough cuts and revenues to balance the state budget, and maintain party unity among Democrats, who control both the House and Senate. The Senate rejected the most recent House budget proposal just last week, so Democratic House leaders were wary about agreeing to talk, but made this offer:
that the House non-concur with the Senate amendments to House Bill 1128 unless the Senate, prior to 3 p.m. today, notifies the House of its agreement to go to Committee of Conference on SB 450. If that message is received, the House will non-concur and request a Committee of Conference on 1128.
That's legislative talk for "you show me first." But Republicans objected to the motion, calling it Senate blackmail that broke parliamentary rules.
I cannot seem to find or recall any time when we've taken what I guess would, it's either a double motion or a double vote or a vote that's contingent upon some other body doing something, and then we, without another vote, are going to be doing something else. And I just, how can we do this? Even if we wanted to do it, under what authority are we being asked to do it, I guess?
We do have some major disagreements between House and Senate on a fundamental of whether gambling would be within the bill that will balance the budget problems that we've been having because of the Great Recession. We do have to achieve that balance. We are trying to provide as many options to the Senate as we can so that we can have that conversation and get it done. What we've been seeing for the last 2 hours, I believe, is a classic filibuster of a extremely uncivil type that I have never before seen in this House, but I've only been here for 14 years.
We have consistently, for the past year and a half, put forward proposals which they have consistently killed or tabled. And, you know, after being kicked in the head, 100 times, you decide maybe I've had enough kicking in the head. I hope we don't have to go into special session. I hope that the House and House and Senate leadership can get together and work out a compromise that's going to fix the problem that they already made.
And joining me at the State Library in Concord, we have Tom Fahey of the New Hampshire Union Leader, Kevin Landrigan of the National Telegraph, and Josh Rogers, New Hampshire Public Radio. Welcome, all of you. Well, Wednesday was an exciting day, I guess you could say, but also, as it turned out, House and Senate leadership did seem to have somewhat of a deal together. They had gotten their heads together. Tell me, Tom, about the coin flip.
Well, the coin flip's really just one of part of a five- or six-part agreement that they've hammered out over the course of the weekend and then Monday and Tuesday. The flip decides whether they'll use a Senate or a House bill to be the budget repair vehicle, if you want to call it that. The tow truck, if you want to call it that, too. If the House bill is used, that implies that the House is going to be in charge of the whole committee session with Marge Smith, Representative Marge Smith, who's chair of the finance, in charge of everything. Being the chair, she gets to drive the truck and take it in the direction the House wants to see it go, which is distinctly away from gambling. If the Senate somehow manages to wrest the wheel away, we'll see it go towards gambling. And it'll be an interesting week once things get started on Monday morning. When this deal was struck, we don't know exactly. And some people are saying, how come a deal was struck without anybody knowing we were in the negotiating room?
Well, are both sides copacetic with the terms of the deal, do you think, Kevin?
Well, I think certainly the top Democratic leaders in the legislature are okay with it, but...
And this is just a deal to talk about.
It's agreement to talk, but under certain specifics, will we talk? In other words, as Tom points out, it's five or six points. We're going to start with what we've all agreed to, meaning gambling is out to start, meaning all the tax increases and new taxes that was in the House plan is out to start with. So in order to get those back in, you've got to get every single member of the conference committee to support putting them back in. Well, and as Tom points out, every single member on the House side of the conference committee opposes expanded gambling.
Well,
in
they
all
usually
forms.
Start with the easy items, right? So, I mean, where's the common ground? Because there were a lot of similar items in both of the bills.
There is a lot of common ground. I mean, there's both proposals include a lot of cuts. Both proposals assume a lot of movement of money around, $80 million in federal stimulus money. From 2011 to 2010, very important for John Lynch running for re-election. What that does is it balances the 2010 budget. I think everyone around the table here agrees that whatever they end up with is not going to deal with the whole $300 million problem. But it's very important for John Lynch's political future that they do balance 2010's budget, and I think whatever they agree to will do that.
I mean, in terms of points of agreement at this point, I mean, it kind of nets out to about 190 some odd million dollars, which, you know, gets you part of the way there. And they're supposed to take that up in the early part of the week. And, you know, by the middle of the week, we should know. And, you know, while Kevin says that there needs to be unanimity among conferees, you know, the constitution of the conferees can change at the whim of the, of, you know, House and Senate leaders. They can swap in and swap out if things get too testy. So we'll see where this goes. I mean, you know, at this time of year, you know, the sides issue becomes, you know, sometimes less partisan and more, you know, chamber to chamber. But unlike a budget year, even though we're discussing this in terms of a budget, they're under no requirement to actually get it all done and actually balance a budget. And we'll see how far they go. And their differences over how far they need to get. You know, the House didn't get to issuing official statement on revenue estimates. Their working number is about $300 million. Republicans say that, you know, perhaps it's $360 million. And so we'll sort of see the push and pull as the week goes on. But, you know, as Kevin says, you know, the House is against gambling. How many people of the Senate conferees are really going to fall on their sword over gambling remains to be seen. Certainly Senator D'Alessandro, and we'll see how long he remains part of the mix.
Well, you know, there was a lot of infighting about what's permitted in a committee of conference. That was much of the debate this week. But, I mean, is there room for new ideas?
That's the sixth point of the deal, is that any other ideas that somebody comes up with can be added in. This is to answer, or sort of as a defense against the House's almost annual argument that an element that the Senate wants to add to a bill isn't germane. You know, it doesn't have to do with the main topic of the bill, and they block a lot of Senate action with that. So the Senate's saying, in a little hand-scrawled note from Senate President Sylvia Larsen at the bottom of the deal, anything else we feel like putting in, basically.
Well, I think anything in furtherance of balancing the budget. I mean, isn't that? But I mean, we'll see what.
Well, Josh, you should have been there that night or day. We don't know when.
Well, I'm not sure what unexplored areas there are for either.
Well, some new tax, for instance, or maybe a new idea for bonding. You know, as Josh mentioned, this $360 million deficit Republicans are talking about. I mean, we're in, you know, when we start guessing between 300 and 360 million, you know, we're pretty high anyhow. But if it's 360, both sides agree, 37 million in cuts. We're solving this with $1 of cuts for every $10 of problem, and that may not go down so well.
No, and I think it's one of the reasons why there's still a lot of really bruised egos over what happened this week. As some of your video pointed out, there was a lot of this discussion about coercion and manipulation and bullying from the Republicans, and some debate on the House floor, even from the House leadership, that, well, we're not sure what the Senate's going to do, so we need this conditional, kind of unprecedented motion to occur. Meanwhile, the Republicans in both the House and Senate had no idea there was this written piece of paper that had already been signed by the leadership. I know House Republican leaders are extremely upset about it, and I know on Thursday there were actual discussions privately about whether we should file an ethics complaint against the leadership of the House for lying to us on the floor about the state of the game.
I mean, we'll see how long people remember this. I mean, you know, it's possible that this conditional notion was kind of too clever for its own good on the one hand, but whether or not people are really going to remember that, I mean, these procedural fights don't tend to translate too well outside of the legislative chamber.
Well, you know, in comparing the bills to went down, and it's a long list in both of them, like over 50 in each one, a lot of repetition, as we were saying. But one of the things that struck me was They said to make a list of all state assets, enterprises, and resources that could be monetized, I guess put up for sale or for lease, almost like a statewide yard sale or something.
Like a yard sale, yeah.
I mean, we at PBS have experience in auctions, so
perhaps. Put you in charge.
I'm wondering what would go up first.
Yeah, they're talking about things like, for instance, we get about $40, $45 million every year in tobacco settlement money from that whole master agreement that all the companies struck with states across the country. You take $45 million over 20 years and maybe sell the rights to that money to someone for a few hundred million dollars, you've solved the problem today. But again, you know, you've borrowed in order to pay for today, and you're saying goodbye to that money in the future.
Well, I think years ago, didn't Maine sell its liquor business?
Yeah, there's liquor. Some states do something similar with their turnpikes. I mean, there's a whole variety of options and that's what this is, to study it. So again, another study. They count the 50 million, but they haven't done anything but study.
Well, you know, gambling is obviously a center point of this whole discussion between both chambers. And on Thursday, the long-awaited report from the Governor's Commission came out. The number one major finding was that expanded gambling would generate additional revenues, but it would also generate additional societal and economic costs. I guess we've heard that before. But it seems they seem to emphasize that any decision requires the long-term interests of the states, not just as they say, short-term financial or other needs. It seems a cautionary note against relying on it without reading too much into it.
Well, I think it is. And if you look at the findings of the report, and if you talk to people, I mean, it's difficult. I mean, there is a certain leap of faith aspect to gambling. And they also said that one component of this that they couldn't even really get a grip on is, and it's a bit nebulous, but what it would mean to New Hampshire's brand. And so moving forward, they need to, you know, some sort of data-driven, proactive, dynamic analysis of this. We'll wait for that. Most of the findings were pretty straightforward. If you build, they did say there's an appetite and a market for more gambling offerings in the state. They did say we need to look at the current laws and regulations we have on the offerings now available. And they said that if you put some sort of facility on the southern border, you're more likely to make money there. So, I mean, there's nothing earth-shattering, but certainly nothing that's going to get gambling over the hump this year and there. And, you know, the governor said that he's still reviewing the report and that he hopes it informs discussions moving forward.
Well, it occupied a number of public hearings, and I'm not sure, a few dozen, I think, people involved in this. Did you see anything new, Tom?
New? Not terribly.
Repetitive?
We know that there are going to be more problem gamblers. That's no surprise. I guess when I look at that report, it helps the whole idea of Rockingham Park a little bit, because we're talking about the best spot is close to the southern New Hampshire border. The kind of facility that they propose down there is the one that would bring the most money. I mean, the report just sort of confirms what the owners of Rockingham and Millennium Gaming have been saying all along. The other interesting thing is that when you talk about problem gambling, it says that we're going to have the most problem gamblers in the vicinity of these casinos. Given that, Salem has voted forever to expand gambling in their own town. I don't think would be a surprise that they might see more problem gambling, but they vote for it anyway because they'd rather have the facility up and running and see the ancillary economic development that comes with it than worry about people who become addicted to gamble.
Well, you know, Kevin, also finding number three was that almost like a warning, if you let it in, it's going to be a lot more difficult to get it out if you ever in the future decide to reverse the expansion of gambling.
That's true, and I think it lent some support, a lot of support, frankly, to Governor Lynch's expressed concerns about proliferation. It essentially says that proliferation is a potential problem and there's nothing you can do about it short of passing a constitutional amendment, which would never happen in New Hampshire, a constitutional amendment to limit expanded gambling to, say, one site in New Hampshire or two sites in New Hampshire. And I think that's an important topic, mainly because I think even in this conference committee, I think the focus is going to be on quantity of expanded gambling. I mean, we've already seen the forces supporting gambling pare back their proposal from initially 6 to 4. We're hearing now that there's a proposal in the already that's been drafted for no more than 2 sites. There's even a proposal that's being worked on right now for only 1 site to try and have it competitively bid. There are supporters of gambling in the House that are in the minority that disagree with folks like Marjorie Smith, who essentially say the House position is against all expanded gambling. They feel that if there's a proposal put to the House for expanded gambling at only, say, 1 location and it's a competitively bid location, not already predetermined location, that more House members would support it. Whether it's a majority or not, I doubt it, but there that is.
Did you get the sense that perhaps the commission members felt they hadn't been given a wide enough purview? I mean, number 4 finding was that whatever way you go on this, whether you're going to expand gambling or not, the state needs to review its regulation of gaming. And that review should be completed, I'm quoting, and necessary changes implemented before any expansion is enacted.
Well, it's a reasonable point. I mean, you look at the way in which charity gaming has expanded, and you look at the resources the state has to properly police that, and they're pretty meager. And I think that, you know, some on the commission as well as the general public, when you actually realize how much gambling is here, it's a good deal of it. And the resources the state puts into making sure that everything is on the up and up are scant. And I do also think that this has been a debate legislatively in terms of these various proposals. Do we approve these things without a sure scheme in place to make sure they're run right, or do we just say, okay, let's just get the licensing money and then we'll sort it out as we go?
Well, I should just say that there's a hearing going on right now that we interrupted to do this taping. That is, maybe we'll do a little look ahead to next week as the financial resource management case proceeds. I believe you just came from the hearing, Kevin?
I did. And at the hearing on Friday morning, Attorney General Mike Delaney essentially offered a pretty kind of heartfelt concession, or not an apology certainly, but an accountability on the part of his department. We made real mistakes. There were failures, significant failures in the department in the handling of this complaint, and as well as the Bureau of Securities and the banking department made mistakes. But this coming Friday, the House and Senate chairman announced that they're going to spend the entire day taking testimony from the public, presuming hearing from many of the more than 150 known investors that have lost tens of millions of dollars in this Ponzi scheme. And they're prepared to have more than a day of public hearing, perhaps several days if that's necessary, to hear from everyone who wants to be heard.
I mean, and that's the legislative end of this. I mean, we still don't really know precisely where the governor and council are on this. They received the report from the attorney general last week. The governor reiterated that if there were failures, people will be held accountable. The governor hasn't been out and about much since then. The council's meeting on Wednesday next, and so we should probably learn a little bit more about what they're feeling about what they take away from the report. And also, you know, it's worth remembering that the attorney general's report, which he described as being the facts in this case, when he presented it to the council in a pretty aggressive kind of prosecutorial manner almost, only went up to the end of 2008. So 2009, you know, the time in which the present attorney general was in his job, there were communications within the banking department that were attached to the report, but they weren't really specifically addressed in the report. And, you know, the waning weeks of FRM is when a lot of money, $20 million plus, was plowed in, and the waning weeks are what's going to be at issue in the one lawsuit that's been filed against the state so far. So that it'll be interesting to watch.
Clearly a story with a lot of growth potential going with it. I just wanted to move on to our final topic. We had another reminder this week, of course, that the November elections are quickly approaching. The Republican Governors Association unleashed a new ad attacking Governor Lynch. We're going to take a look at that in just a second, and then you're going to see what many are calling the most memorable campaign ad of the year so far. Let's take a look.
John Lynch has lost touch with the people of New Hampshire. Our state is facing a more than $200 million deficit. And what's John Lynch's budget plan? He's put an income tax on tens of thousands of business owners and more than 60 other taxes and fees.
I'm Dale Peterson, and I'm after the Republican nomination for Alabama Agriculture Commissioner. I've been a farmer, a businessman, a cop, a Marine during Vietnam. So listen up. Alabama Ag Commissioner is one of the most powerful positions in Alabama, responsible for $5 billion. Bet you didn't know that. You know why? Thugs and criminals. If they can keep you in the dark, they can do whatever they want with all that money. And they don't give a rip about Alabama. Here we are, losing three family farms a day. Illegals bust in by the thousands, and Alabama's unemployment's at an all-time high. And what are my opponents doing about it? Stealing yard signs in the dark of night from my supporters. Norman Grace brags on his Facebook page about receiving contributions from industries he would regulate. Bragging about receiving illegal money on Facebook. Who on earth would support such a dummy? And why? We're Republicans. We should be better than that. I'm Dale Peterson. I'll name names and take no prisoners. Give me the Republican nomination for Ag Commission, and let's show Alabama we mean business.
All right, well, I could just see our candidate in Alabama strolling off to get himself some liberal varmints.
Yeah, it's pretty impressive. I have to say, the guy looks good for 64 years old, especially with the gun over his shoulder.
I mean, he's running agriculture. I shudder to think there's corrections. But,
It's just a reminder that, Kevin, there were ruffled feathers here when we saw the Lynch Lies ad saying, oh, that just goes too far, but doesn't seem to even approach this.
No, it pales in significance, really, to what we're going to see this year. I think as we saw in the states, I don't know if Tom feels this way, but as we saw in some of these states that held primaries, there's only one unifying principle. That is, if you're a member of establishment, you're an endangered species. What that means is that every challenger to every incumbent is going to be urged to attack the incumbent. What that also means is every incumbent, in order to remain, is going to have to render the opponent unacceptable to the voter. So you're going to have to attack the challenger, and you're going to have to render the challenger incapable of running, right? Mm-hmm. I mean,
yeah, I think it's going to bring nasty campaigns to a new level this year because there is so much at stake. I think every challenger starts with a leg up over any other election in the past because people are dissatisfied, and this is typical for a down economy, and this economy is really down with the stock market performance last week or this week. We don't know whether we're really out of this thing or not. We could take another dip downward.
Well, I'm going to have to wrap it up at that, and thank you all for joining us. Tom Fahey, Kevin Landrigan, Josh Rogers, appreciate you being here. Finally, it is easy among the heated debates of the week to forget that things could be worse and that we have been through tougher times before. But on Wednesday, we got a reminder of that. Lafayette Day in New Hampshire.
It was the 185th anniversary of the death of Marquis de Lafayette, the young French nobleman who joined the American cause in the Revolution and was made a general by George Washington. Lafayette played a key role in winning French support for the Revolution and in the final defeat of the British at Yorktown.
Lafayette returned to America one final time in 1824 and stayed for 13 months, visiting all 24 states and Washington City. Dubbed the nation's guest, this 67-year-old elder statesman who limped and carried a cane and wore a hairpiece, who had held no political or military authority either in America or in France since 1792, was greeted by over 3 million Americans, one-fourth of the entire population, and treated like a conquering hero, like a Caesar or an Alexander throughout the Union. There was an outpouring of love and admiration for the last surviving major general of our Revolution. So, why does New Hampshire celebrate Lafayette Day, and why should it celebrate Lafayette Day? And why should we join in honoring his memory? Simple. It's very simple. Because Lafayette was the best friend that this country ever had.
To the people of New Hampshire, the devoted tender of my grateful, affectionate, and profound respect. God bless America. Vive la France. Long life for the friendship between America and France. Thank you very much.
sera, il vienne jusque dans nos bras, égorgé nos fils et nos compagnes.